On tonight's program, a roundtable of epic proportions. And now, the host of the West Coast Truth, Russell Scott.
Jim Fetzer, welcome to the program. You're one of the main organizers of the event. Tell us a bit about yourself and tell us about the event that you're hosting here on June 15th through the 17th.
Well, thank you, Russell. Yes, I graduated from Princeton and served 4 years as a commissioned officer in the Marine Corps, earned my PhD in the history and the philosophy of science, and spent 35 years teaching principally courses in logic, critical thinking, and scientific reasoning. I published quite a lot. I founded Scholars for 9/11 Truth in December of 2005. And I've been very deeply, actively involved in 9/11 research and also research on JFK and the death of Senator Paul Wellstone of Minnesota ever since. Joshua Blakeney and I believe that the Toronto hearings had too narrow a focus and that it would be a good idea to broaden the boundaries of 9/11 truth by inviting speakers to address the controversial issues that divide the community, since I'm convinced that unless we confront them, we'll never resolve them. So we're going to have, six different sessions. We're going to start off about what did or didn't happen at the Pentagon. We're going to have two sessions on how the Twin Towers were destroyed. We're going to have another session about the crash sites and the fabrication of the flights and so forth, a very intriguing topic. Then we're going to have a session about who was responsible and why, and we're going to conclude with a session about the role of the media, the myth, the media, and the message.
Webster Tarpley, welcome to the program. Introduce yourself and tell me why 9/11 was an inside job.
Well, my approach to this is the political one. I focus on the political evidence, which is inexplicably neglected, I think, by most of the people researching in the field. In other words, I believe there's been a tremendous overemphasis on technical points and a corresponding atrophy in the political analysis. My points to prove this are essentially two. One is the question of the drills, the exercises, the military activities, some of them real combat, that were being used in order to prepare and to execute virtually every aspect of 9/11. In other words, you name an aspect of 9/11, the chances are we can come up with a drill or exercise that was used either to prepare that or to execute it. And this includes all the main features, right? Planes flying into buildings, buildings crashing down, the paralysis of the air defense system, the absence of any effective counterterrorism, the special alerts at U.S. military bases, on and on, right? It's a very long list. It's basically exhaustive. And all of these, I'm up to a count of about 46 of them. Of the 46, about half of those take place in the decade or so leading up to 9/11. That is the testing, the vetting of these hypotheses. Of course, Condoleezza Rice said nobody ever thought planes could be used as missiles. Well, they'd been drilling that in numerous variations for a decade. And then on the day of, we have the National Reconnaissance Office drill, planes fly into skyscrapers, the New York City Red X drill, buildings crash down. We've got the huge complex around the Vigilant Guardian air drills, which essentially are fake hijackings that turn into real hijackings. The central concept here is always the drill goes live. The drill is taken live. The drill is flipped live. And we can even see that in other cases historically, but this is by now the most massive one. So this huge complex, and again, just about completely neglected, right? The people who know the standard cliches of 9/11 generally don't know anything about this, or they, at most, they might know some of the drills for the air defense suppression, but they don't know the drills that actually carried out the activities. Let me hasten to add, the Afghan war was drilled in advance. In other words, the mobilization to strike Afghanistan, that had been drilled in May of 2001. The other question is, the angel is next. 9/11 has to be seen politically. It is a coup d'etat. It is an attempt to redirect the entire U.S. government, the press, the political parties, Congress, public opinion, and it grows out of a growing desperation of the Anglo-American predicament when it comes to world domination. We should talk about this in some detail, right? The crisis of the dollar, the inherent rottenness and weakness of Wall Street, the City of London, and other U.S., U.K., banking centers. And there's a coup faction. In other words, there are people who carry this out. The coup faction, in my view, is located at the interface between Wall Street on the one hand and the State Department, Pentagon, and intelligence agencies on the other. If you can think of a figure like Alan Dulles, you will see that this is the kind of person that would be involved. And we can look at some more specific examples of this. But in the middle of this mayhem on 9/11, the coup faction comes forward. They speak. They say what they want. They identify themselves. They call in. They give a series of code words that indicates that the coup faction is cutting across the top level of the entire U.S. government. And they essentially communicate to Bush what it is they want him to do. Bush is not a witting participant, right? So the idea is, they say, in effect, that this part we have to reconstruct based on what he's then done. Go on television, say, Al-Qaeda, 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 Bin Laden, Bin Laden, Bin Laden, Afghanistan, 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 War of Civilizations begins. Don't go on television and say coup d'etat, treason, putsch, or what had really happened. And there was not much danger of that with Bush, but conceivably it could have happened. There could have been patriotic generals or others in the process. So these huge things that are completely forgotten, I think, because of the lack of political focus on the part of many 9/11 people, or anyway, the failure to do this, I think, has been a terrible thing. So those are my ideas. And then, of course, the anecdotal evidence goes on forever, but most of it fits in within those frameworks.
Kevin Barrett, welcome to the program. Tell us about yourself and tell me why, more than 10 years after the fact, 9/11 is still relevant.
Well, thanks, Russell. You know, I agree with most of what I've heard from the other speakers, especially Webster. But I think that the angle I've taken on this is that this coup faction, as Webster has said elsewhere, was aiming to create a clash of civilizations between Islam and the West. And that is a monumental and historic and very troubling enterprise. Religion has played a role in conflicts in the past, and often a very detrimental role. It exacerbates conflicts. The West, of course, has had this experience of going crazy with the Crusades and the wars of religion, probably more than any other culture, and reviving this kind of religious fanaticism for the next big war of civilizations. Now that the communist enemy has disappeared at the end of the Cold War, is a very, very troubling thing, not just because I'm a Muslim and don't particularly appreciate being at the receiving end of probably the worst wave of hatred, bigotry, and xenophobia that's ever been generated, or at least it's comparable with the sorts of things the Nazis were doing, but also because we're talking about 1.5 billion people here who are sitting on some very valuable resources, who have been major league victims of Western imperialism, colonialism, and who are increasingly going to be having the weapons to fight back. So I'm very concerned that false flag attack on 9/11 by setting off this war of civilizations could very well lead to actual damage, not only to the Islamic world, where we've seen well over a million Muslims killed and perhaps 10 million plus made homeless and had their lives destroyed. The whole elite of the Muslim world has been hunted down, killed, kidnapped, tortured, and destroyed. The best Muslims, not the terrorists, the people who actually stand up and speak the truth and lead the community are the ones who have been targeted for destruction by this genocidal campaign. So, unfortunately, at some point, there may well be an actual quote-unquote terrorist backlash. Frankly, I wouldn't blame any Pakistanis for being angry enough to want to grab those nuclear weapons that they have and send them towards U.S. military bases, the way the U.S. has been hunting and killing innocent Pakistanis with the drones. So, you know, I don't know when such a thing might actually happen or whether it'll be more false flag stuff that sets off the next escalation. But in any way you look at it, we're on a roller coaster heading for doom. And the best way to get off it is to revisit 9/11. Because once the American people and the people of the West understand what really happened on 9/11, that this was a false flag attack designed to demonize Muslims and Islam, they will, I think, have a shift in public opinion comparable to what happened after World War II with regard to Western views towards Jews and Judaism. That is, that Muslims will probably undergo a period of actually the kind of privilege that Jews have had between World War II and 9/11. And I think that this is the best possible way to roll back American aggression, which is the biggest factor. Well, it's not American. It's really run by world financiers, but whatever you want to call it, that's the biggest threat to world peace, and the best way to neutralize it is by revisiting and exposing 9/11.
Greg Felton, welcome back to the program, fourth time on the show.
Thanks a lot, Russell. Glad to be here again. One of my favorite things to do. My name is Greg Felton. I have a Master of Arts in Political Science. I'm a journalist. I've been a journalist since 1993. I began to write on the Middle East in 1995 when I was a columnist for the Vancouver Courier. And over that time, I managed to give myself a thorough education in Middle East politics, history, Palestine, probably better than I could have received at a university, which would probably have steered me in the traditional direction of Israel is a wonderful democracy and the Arabs all just want to destroy Israel. So I got, an education very, very beneficial. My perspective of September the 11th is perhaps a little different than some of the people have mentioned. I look at the attack on the World Trade Center not as an event in itself, in that I don't see that it was designed to, say, necessarily terrorize the United States. I see it as a means to an end. The objective was the Patriot Act, which was passed about 6 weeks after the attack. The destruction of the World Trade Center was a means by which Israel managed to turn the United States into a full-blown collaborator in the destruction of the Arab and generally the Muslim world. And it's my view that the United States has been slipping into fascism in a particularly precipitous way since Ronald Reagan became president. I determined that Jimmy Carter was truly the last president of the United States because every president since then has been elected by narrow pressure groups, whether it's Christian Zionists, Jews, neocons, or of George W. Bush, the project for a new American century. So my point of view is that the reason for the September the 11th attack was essentially to serve the interests of Israel, which was primarily the director of the attack. Nobody knows who specifically carried it out, but the interplay and the cross-pollination between Israel and the higher echelons of American government is now so thoroughly complete. It's like the Borg. I mean, resistance is futile. You're part machine, you're part human. And the machine right now has taken over the United States to the point where the U.S. can no longer be considered an independent country. The Congress is thoroughly Zionized. The Supreme Court is Zionized. The White House is little more than Israel's outpost on the Potomac. The country basically has been eaten out from within. This is why I call my first book was The Host and the Parasite, and I outlined the ways in which Israel, through the Israel lobby in the United States, was a parasite that has been slowly consuming the host and essentially living off of it, giving the United States no benefit whatever, and using the United States as an all-purpose economic, political, and military support system for Israel. So my point of view is that Israel is behind September the 11th.
Well, we're going to take a call now. John David Ebert, you're writing the book, Age of Catastrophe. You must have some thoughts on September 11th.
Yes, I do. I have a few thoughts, although my thoughts are not necessarily so much of the political kind as more into the philosophical. My background is in philosophy, and I see the attack as an ontological attack designed specifically to make the entire planet the target. I don't see it as a conspiracy, but I do see it as an attempt to continue in the tradition of bringing down the walls of Western cities. Western cities in the Middle Ages, of course, had huge walls around them, and gradually with the invention of gunpowder, with its bringing over from China by the Ottoman Turks and the introduction into the West, gunpowder gradually brought these walls around our cities down, and over a long period of time the walls came down, and by the time you get in the 19th century with explosive shell-type ballistic technologies, the walls were done away with once and for all, but the ontological walls were still there, philosophically speaking, and I think that the intent of the attacks on 9-1-1 were to bring down the walls ontologically, the metaphysical walls around us, so that we would feel vulnerable and naked and open in a new sense, to in the sense that the entire planet now becomes a field where anyone can be attacked at any time. And I think that it was spectacularly successful in that respect. So my point of view is a little more of a philosophical one rather than a political one.
Make your plugs, John, and ask the panel a question.
My question is, I'm a bit of a skeptic about the conspiracy, and my question is, why postulate the need for a manufactured attack when, if we look at the attacks coming out of Al-Qaeda, you know, starting with the first attack in 1993 on the World Trade Center, and then in 96 with the Khobar Towers attack, and then in 97 with Luxor, and then in 98 with the attacks on the embassies in Kenya, and then in 2000 with the USS Cole. I mean, there's clearly a pattern there where the attacks get larger and larger and more ambitious, and 9-1-1 seems, from my point of view, to fit right in to that pattern of attacks on a larger scale. I don't see any need to I mean, it seems to me that to hypothesize a conspiracy is almost a way of ignoring the evolution of those attacks and putting 9-1-1 into the context of them as the sort of grand climax of this series of attacks. So that's my question, is this sort of this evolutionary approach. And by the way, I have a new book coming out in November, The Age of Catastrophe, which will be out from Farland Books in November.
Thank you very much.
May I attempt that one?
I was going to call on you, Webster. Go ahead. Thank you, John.
I'm afraid that your remarks are of a certain breathtaking superficiality. In other words, you cannot accept a catalog of events as if they were all self-evident. And as a historian, I would reprove in you the tendency of modern philosophy. What you are missing is what Hegel called die Anstrengung des Begriffes, in other words, the work of creating the concept. And the work of creating the concept in this case is, you cite, among other things, the World Trade Center first attack, right back under Clinton. Well, I have quite a discussion of that in my book here, 9/11 Synthetic Terror Made in USA, fifth edition. And what we find, of course, with that first attempt is that this was a group of patsies, rather hapless individuals, fanatics, psychotics, mercenaries, double agents, megalomaniacs, mythomaniacs. But in the middle was an FBI informant. And we have this fascinating tape where the FBI informant is on the telephone with his case officer, and the informant said, I told you to use a non-explosive powder in this truck, but you, the FBI, insisted that it be actual explosives. And that is what then caused the explosion. In other words, there was a perfectly good plan. If they wanted to entrap these patsies, they could have done it. But it was clear the FBI wanted the explosion. They wanted the incident. And if we had time, and if you would make a careful list, I think I could go back with the help of some of the colleagues on the discussion and refute just about every one of these other incidents that you call a self-evident event. In other words, I think what you've left out is deception, quite frankly. The question of manipulation. And the factor, you know, the Venetians, of course, Venetian secret intelligence, past masters of this, they organized the Crusades. But specifically on philosophy, I do take time in my book to see what the leading modern philosophers say about 9/11. And I looked at Jürgen Habermas, the leader of the Frankfurt School, or what's left of it. I looked at Jacques Derrida. In the meantime, he's passed away. But at that time, he'd been the leader of this mass of what we could call French deconstructionism and existentialism. And then, of course, the neo-pragmatist Richard Rorty. So the three of the principal streams of philosophy. And the common denominator of all of them is they all strike out because they all fail to get that fine-grained analysis, what is actually going on here. And it means that you're then reduced to dealing clichés in extremely superficial concepts. And what I'm trying to say is if you put all those events under the magnifying glass of real historical analysis, they fall apart. You're dealing with a constructive fraud on world public opinion. And, of course, it's very dangerous because this is how the financier elite, the Bilderbergers that I've been observing for the past 4 or 5 days here out in the sun of northern Virginia, this is how the Bilderbergers and similar groups of finance oligarchs propose to rule the world. They have to use false flag events to get what they want because they can't announce their real intentions.
Yeah, I'd like to say that I appreciate your comments about Hobart and the East African attacks, but I'd like to correct, I think, one misperception. The concept of Al-Qaeda as being this great terrorist organization is more of an illusion than fact. In fact, the term Al-Qaeda did not exist until the end of the Mujahideen resistance against the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan toward the late 1990s. And the term Al-Qaeda, according to one of Bin Laden's closest associates, Dr. Saad al-Faqih, did not mean military base or any sort of base of operations. It meant essentially a database, which in Arabic is rendered as Al-Qaeda al-Banayat, which is essentially the way Bin Laden administered the information coming in and out of his guest house in Peshawar, Pakistan. So I would dissent from the notion that Al-Qaeda even exists. This is essentially a bogeyman that was invented largely by the West based upon either a mistranslation or a deliberate misrepresentation of Arabic. Because it's always very easy to say, well, there's Al-Qaeda out there, so this amorphous, nameless bogeyman. And it's very hard to sort of wrap your head around. You just have to accept it or not accept it. And it becomes the all-purpose devil figure. As far as the bombings in East Africa goes, there is no evidence that Bin Laden had anything to do with it. The only attacks that Osama Bin Laden has admitted to were the bombings in Dahran and Khobar, both of which are in Saudi Arabia. Bombings that have taken place besides that, including the World Trade Center, have never been traced to any sort of organized Muslim organization. I think we can say with reasonable certainty that the September the 11th attack on the Trade Center and the Pentagon was planned and executed by forces in the United States and Israel. So I think we should probably not see the World Trade Center along the continuum of any series of attacks against Western civilization or see any of this as a clash of civilizations. This is a very specific, politically motivated act of self-sabotage to achieve a very specific political objective, and that is the wholesale demonization of Muslim society such that Israel could convince the world to stand down its defenses, its morality, its sense of humanity, and acquiesce in the mass murder of Muslims.
Just a couple of, I would have a couple of dissents on that. First of all, Al-Qaeda exists and how. Al-Qaeda is the CIA Arab Legion. It was created by Robert Gates, Zbigniew Brzezinski, and Michael Vickers, who is sitting in the Pentagon today. He just formed a whole new intelligence agency in the Pentagon. So it does exist, and it is the infantry that NATO is using to attack, for example, Libya last year. The people that are now running Libya are basically resting on Al-Qaeda bayonets, right? That's who's attacking the Libyan, the Tripoli International Airport. Attacking in Syria, who do you think did the Houla massacre? The Houla massacre was done by Al-Qaeda death squads working for NATO. Concerning the East African, Sergeant Ali Mohammed, Bin Laden's valet, right, a member of the U.S. military, but assigned to helping Bin Laden, was the guy who brought pictures of this to bin Laden and showed him the pictures so that he could be plausibly linked. So there is plenty of evidence linking somebody called bin Laden to this event.
No, there's No. Bin Laden approved of it. He was very pleased with the event, but there's absolutely no evidence that he had any planning or executive role in it. Bin Laden.
Please see 9/11 Synthetic Terror for the big story.
Yeah, well, I've read the story myself, and there is no evidence that bin Laden had anything to do with it. Bin Laden is not shy about admitting responsibility for attacks. Had he done so, there would have been no reason for him not to have admitted it, and he has never admitted it.
Wanted to suggest to Webster that there's not as much divergence between his view and Greg's as he was implying, because he's acknowledging that Al-Qaeda is a creation of the American intelligence agencies. Osama bin Laden was our man in Afghanistan. And I certainly agree with Greg that there is no evidence, and never has been, that Osama bin Laden had anything to do with 9/11. When he was first questioned about it, of course, he observed that it was contrary to the tenets of Islam to murder innocent women and children. He observed that there's a government within the government in the United States that was seeking to cast responsibility on Muslims, an observation, by the way, that was made by no less an American authority than Bill Clinton, who also observed that there was a government within the government and that he did not control it. And where we know Osama died on or about 15 December 2001, and that we've had a succession of fake Obamas ever since, most conveniently, of course, the second killing of Osama bin Laden with the raid on the compound that was for purely a calculated political purposes to relieve pressure on Obama from closing Guantanamo, where the tip allegedly originated, and of course excusing having troops in Pakistan since they could not have led the raid on the compound had they not been there, but most of all, of course, taking the pressure off of his birth certificate. So I think we have quite a lot of evidence to substantiate aspects of what both of you are saying, Webster, that it was American intelligence creation, and Greg on the role of Osama here as a fall guy and a patsy.
John, do you have any follow-ups to that?
No, other than that, the sequence of attacks that I've listed are, you know, just sort of the mainstream, common, official idea of history. And I appreciate the questioning of that, but I think that I haven't heard anything concrete here. I haven't heard anything except an objectionist ideology. I haven't heard anyone here say that these attacks that constitute the history of Al-Qaeda were fabricated and given concrete evidence for the fabrications of the attacks. I mean,
well, let me respond by observing that virtually everything we've been told about 9/11 by the government is provably false. Elias Davison has shown the government has never been able to prove that these terrorists were aboard any of those planes. David Ray Griffin and A.K. Dudney have shown that all of the phone calls were faked. Colonel George Nelson, U.S. Air Force retired, has observed that although there would be millions of uniquely identifiable component parts from the four crash sites, the government has yet to produce even one. When an FBI official was asked why the National Transportation Safety Board had not investigated any of these crash sites for the first time in its history, he replied that it wasn't necessary because we saw them on television. But we didn't see what happened in Shanksville on television. We most certainly did not see what happened at the Pentagon on television. And the one and only frame the Pentagon has ever produced to substantiate its claim that the building was hit by a plane turns out to be a very small aircraft just above a gate mechanism, where when I had Jack White, a legendary photo analyst from JFK Studies, size a Boeing 757 to the tail of that plane, the image of the 757 was more than twice as long as the plane shown there. There are a host of other proofs we could adduce about the fakery involved here. For example, the fires in the Twin Towers didn't burn hot enough or long enough to cause steel to weaken, much less melt. The buildings are blowing apart, not a function of a gravitationally driven collapse, which we did see with Building 7. But what we have with building with 1 and 2, with the North and the South Tower, is completely different. And in fact, this is one of the first and most obvious indications that the government has been massively lying to us from scratch. There are many others, but I can't believe that anyone who actually stops to take a look about the fact that these two buildings are blowing apart in every direction from the top down and being converted into millions of cubic yards of very fine dust, could have any doubts that this was some kind of inside job and that the government has been deceiving us in order to instill fear into the American people, to make us susceptible to manipulation to promote its political agenda, which included a complete reversal of American foreign policy, so that instead of never attacking any country that had not attacked us first, now we were launching wars of aggression in violation of international law, the UN Charter, and even the US Constitution into Afghanistan, where we are looting its mineral riches, and to Iraq, where we were seeking control of its oil, but where we were also dismantling sophisticated Arab states to benefit Israel, which had more to gain from 9/11 than any other entity.
Joshua, welcome to the program.
Yeah, I'm Joshua Blakeney. I've been pursuing graduate studies here in Canada on the origins of the war on terror, so basically 9/11. And as a result, I found myself being assailed in the mainstream media by individuals such as Jonathan Kay, who Webster debated recently. And I would concur with, I think, Dr. Barrett and with Professor Fetzer and with Greg especially, that 9/11 was largely a Zionist operation. And I would like to, I think it's important that we should dwell upon the inconsistencies between the position of Webster and that of Greg, which is, you know, either Bin Laden was involved or he wasn't, either Al-Qaeda were involved or they weren't, either Al-Qaeda does exist as a coherent and autonomous actor, or maybe not autonomous, but a coherent actor, or it doesn't. And, you know, I think Webster Tarpley is one of the greatest journalists of our time, but I think that on 9/11, Webster, there's you portrayed it as a kind of extension of American empire. You just cited Alan Dulles, Zbigniew Brzezinski, you often invoke. But if Al-Qaeda weren't involved, as Elias Davidson's demonstrated, then the fact that Brzezinski, for example, created the Mujahideen as part of the Cold War is trivial. You might as well talk about Vaclav Havel in relation to 9/11, because it's just as relevant as Bin Laden, if Bin Laden wasn't involved in 9/11. And so my position on this, my conclusions is that 9/11, it was actually a kind of deviation from the traditional American empire's policy. You know, many scholars now, Walt and Mearsheimer of the University of Chicago and Harvard, James Petras, who's a leftist, you know, Kevin Barrett, Steven Snigowski, many have demonstrated that the post 9/11 policy was one that kind of deviated from the US's traditional Middle East policy, which was characterized by the Eisenhower Doctrine, which was one of trying to foment stability in so the American empire could despoil oil resources via Arab potentates, and that the post 9/11 policy was one of trying to destabilize the Middle East in order to weaken Israel's enemies. Take, for example, the debate you were in the other day, Webster, you know, where you're up against two, well, I would say ardent Zionists, David Frum and Jonathan Kay. Jonathan Kay's written two books in his life, one Attacking the Truthers and one co-authored with a Mossad agent. So time and time again, it's Zionists who are trying to address the 9/11 issue, trying to defend the official story of 9/11. And I would say that to talk about Alan Dulles and Zbigniew Brzezinski distracts us from the real kind of nouveau riche cabal that was taking over. You know, I'd say Brzezinski, Dulles, you know, the American empire, the kind of old money in the American empire, the Ancien regime, they were ousted on 9/11 with a coup d'etat done by this kind of new faction. And one criticism I would say that some don't address that. Some don't address the fact that 9/11, the post-Cold War policy, was one that largely was aligned with the Israeli policy. In my academic research, I did an intellectual exercise. I looked up what books Benjamin Netanyahu had written in his life. I don't think Benjamin Netanyahu is a puppet. I think he's quite a smart guy and is one of the brains behind all this. And I found a book by Netanyahu called Terrorism, How the West Can Win, authored in 1986, the year I was born, in which he was basically using all the vocabulary that didn't enter our lexicons until after 9/11, you know, a war on international terrorism and so on. So we could cite the Grand Chessboard as a text and relate that to 9/11. But I think that's it's wrong to couple those together. I think it's far more relevant to couple, you know, Netanyahu's scholarship or Netanyahu's books, you might say, in relation to 9/11. And I think that we need to dwell upon these differences in the truth movement. And that's why Professor Fetzer and I have organized the Vancouver hearings in order to address our differences in the truth movement. Either Bin Laden was involved or he wasn't. Either Al-Qaeda exists or they didn't. Either the hijackers boarded the planes or they didn't. I think these things need to be addressed in a forthright manner.
Kevin Tarpley Felton.
Let me, okay. Okay. Since I think I was addressed in this.
You were. I don't want to ignore Kevin. So,
all right, fine. Kevin, say something.
Okay. Well, you have one point to make about this, which is that Netanyahu's book ends with an essay by Bernard Lewis, who is the dean of the British Orientalists. And Bernard Lewis was the man who first met with George Bush after 9/11. If you actually read that essay contributed by Bernard Lewis to Netanyahu's book, which was part of the invention of the War on Terror back in 1979, was the beginning of it at the Jerusalem Conference on International Terrorism, what you'll see is that Bernard Lewis carries forth his lifetime project of creating Al-Qaeda. That is, Bernard Lewis has long been calling for the creation of a new modeled on the assassins of the Middle Ages, this offshoot of the Shia that had laid waste to the Middle East and destabilized the region. Basically, what...
Okay, we've lost the audio. Webster Tarpley, go ahead.
Let me just address, first of all, what I think is an overemphasis on the Israeli role. I think this is a distortion which is not supported by the facts, right? That you seem to be saying Netanyahu runs the United States or something like this. I think the obvious differences in power and potential are in front of everybody's eyes to see. Israel is a client state of the United States.
Oh, please.
Could not exist without U.S. military power. Could not exist without U.S. subsidies. And of course, the British, as Kevin was saying with Bernard Lewis, right? The British Arab Bureau is also a big power, and the British role on the Israeli side, I think, is also quite great. What he's talking about is Bernard Lewis's graduating thesis on the origins of Ismailism, and that this is where the Hashashin and the old man of the mountain come from. But let's look at the U.S. tradition, right? We're told that 9/11 is a deviation from the U.S. tradition. Well, I'm sorry, that's just baloney. That's just off the wall. We can go back to the foundation of U.S. imperialism, which I would say starts with the battleship Maine in Havana Harbor in 1898, I believe it is. And this is used by then the Hearst newspapers to run a hysterical campaign, very much like what we saw in 9/11. The explosion that sank the Maine was inside the vessel, not outside. That's the finding of Admiral Hyman Rickover, the founder of the U.S. nuclear navy. We can then take it up to, say, the Vietnam War, the Gulf of Tonkin incident. This is the provocation that starts the Vietnam War. It's attended by all that hysteria, the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, seen by many as the immediate precursor of the post 9/11 resolution, right, that went through the Congress. Ron Paul voted for it, worth mentioning. Barbara Lee did not, but that's what got us on the road to the Afghan War. I would also point out the Kennedy assassination in many ways is a preparation for the Vietnam War. And here we get right to the heart of the matter. This is where Alan Dulles plays a role and is certainly part of the cover-up and may well have been part of the, in a general way, was certainly involved in the execution. The general So some of the generals who were in power during the Kennedy assassination were proposing Operation Northwoods. My heavens, that's the American tradition. Here's a plan for a provocation to attack Cuba, and it's not used in the case of Cuba, but it is then used in the Gulf of Tonkin. So it's not like it didn't happen, right? Kay was claiming that this didn't happen, and of course it did. Lyman Lemnitzer is the general who signed Northwoods. He then went on to become the NATO commander in Europe. And here we get into Gladio, the stay-behind organizations. The stay-behind organizations are U.S. creations, they're NATO creations, and they are deposits of weapons, explosives, with guerrilla fighters grouped around them. The goal is, of course, to start guerrilla warfare in case the Soviets overrun Western Europe. So I think the tradition argument... all of this stuff seems to be making the U.S., it's an attempt to make the U.S. look good at the expense of somebody else. And I
disagree. It's a matter of facts, Webster. And I mean, I would say that you could list all the U.S.'s false flag attacks, and I could come back at you and list all of Israel's false flag attacks. And you're just arguing from history.
Yeah, but my argument is not based on this at all. My argument is based on the 46 drills. The 46 drills run by U.S. military officers, U.S. intelligence officers. This is an American operation, and my book
Pentagon
is called...
The Pentagon was occupied by Zionists. It's well demonstrated.
Oh, I'm sure.
It's well demonstrated. And also, Webster, can I make one point? It's not baloney, because I have to ask you, how many Middle Eastern countries did the U.S. invade and intervene in overtly with
but
its military
that this is
in
to help
the Cold
the
War?
Israelis. This
how
is,
many?
This is not necessarily to help the Israelis at all. Let me repeat. My book is called 9/11 Synthetic Terror. Made in USA.
And sorry, Webster. Webster.
Please stop interrupting, guys. I'm sorry. Made in USA means not made in Saudi Arabia, not made in Pakistan, not made in the myth-drenched regions of Bora Bora or whatever it is. And also not made in Israel in the sense that it was a plan concocted by the Zionist conspiracy. The idea that Israel dominates every feature of U.S. life, down to the detail, is simply a grotesque distortion. It is scientifically and historically wrong, and it plays right into the hands of the CIA, because this is one of their favorite lines. The CIA agent in the Middle East is always there to say, we didn't do it, those Mossadniks did it, right? They're the ones who did it, we didn't do it. So this is what you're getting. You're essentially whitewashing the main center of imperialism and dumping it all on this subsidiary of U.S.-British imperialism.
Joshua, I think you're quite right about that. The September 11th attack was contrary to traditional U.S. policy, which has been stability in the Middle East for the sake of oil. But I think if you look further than that, if you go back to around the beginning of the 80s, we can see a clear beginning of how this began to happen. It was with Reagan's administration, as I argue in my book, The Host and the Parasite, How Israel's Fifth Column Consumed America, that Israel, throughout the election of 1980, began to infiltrate the American government in a major way, such that by the end of Reagan's time, oil had ceased to become the prime determinant of U.S. policy. And by the time, Clinton becomes president, we have the United States almost as a full-blown subsidiary of Israel. And I'm afraid Mr. Tarpley, for all of his book writing, has got this issue completely asked backwards, because there's no scenario conceivable under which you could claim the United States is the dominant partner with Israel when you see how freely and with such impunity Israel humiliates the United States, ignores the United States, bullies its politicians, lies on its American television, extorts money from the U.S. Did you know that American citizens have to pay interest on the money that Israel is given in aid from the American Treasury? Israel is the only country in the U.S. that gets its annual aid in one lump sum in January, deposited in an interest-bearing account at the Federal Reserve. Americans pay interest on aid to Israel. I'm afraid that I just can't see how the United States can be in charge of a relationship when it voluntarily allows itself to be humiliated and its economy plundered. So I'm afraid Mr. Tarpley is looking at this through an old prism that sort of selectively cuts out certain frequencies of light.
Let me say that my prism is not the one of resentment or hate or a vendetta or I don't know what. The idea that this tiny postage stamp of land in the Middle East controls the immense continental resources of the United States through some kind of an automatic or mystical process, it's simply grotesque. And then when we add in the British, the entire Anglo-American imperialist system, according to you, is being wagged by the dog. Let me point out, in Samuel Huntington's scenario, the War of Civilizations, the Clash of Civilizations, we have the scenario precisely for the Third World War. And what happens to Israel in the course of that is that they are annihilated. They are overrun and it ceases to exist. And Samuel Huntington basically says, you know, too bad for them. I think this discussion is simply a dead end because it leads us away from the relevant evidence. The relevant evidence are the drills and Angel is next. Those are the two cardinal points. And any approach that leads away from these things is bankrupt and it's suspect.
No, it's not. I mean, you mistake Israel for a country. What's at issue here is not some postage stamp little backwater on the eastern edge of the Mediterranean, but that Israel is almost a supranational country. If you look at the degree to which Israel lobbies in Canada, the United States, England, throughout the world, manage to extort behavior and coerce conduct from foreign governments, you have to look at Israel as more than just the size of the land that it is illegally occupying. It is much larger than that. And I think you need to redefine what you mean by Israel. Israel is like a world cancer that has infected the body politic of the human race to such a degree that national governments are not able to formulate national policy. And that is simply true of the United States. It can't make any policy without permission of Israel. And you look at Obama and other presidents basically groveling on their knees to kiss the ring of the Israel lobby every year at the AIPAC is just humiliating. And why would anybody humiliate himself on his own soil unless he had no choice?
Okay. Janet Phelan, get your question in.
Yes, thank you. Yes, my name is Janet Phelan. I am a journalist and contributing writer to activistpost.com. And my question goes to motive. I believe that the 9/11 Truth Movement has done an excellent job pointing out the holes in the official story of what happened on 9/11. But I would like to hear from possibly Mr. Tarpley as to what the motive would be. And this is taking together both the attacks on September 11th and the subsequent anthrax mailings. What would be the purpose for the United States government to launch this level of attack as a false flag attack on its own citizens? Thank you.
First of all, the question of the enemy image, I think Kevin Barrett addressed this before. The enemy image plays a huge role in the writings of Carl Schmitt, the inspirer of the neocons, and also in the writings of really Brzezinski and Huntington. And the question was that once the Cold War had ended, the enemy image of the Soviet communist or Warsaw Pact trooper was no longer there. So in order to promote political cohesion and to maintain oligarchical rule, to maintain the power of the finance oligarchs, what today we would call the 1%, it's essential to have a conflict going on. Otherwise, the social injustices inside the country become overwhelming interest, as they've done to some degree today. So that's a part of it. The other part is that the neocons and their ilk were very unhappy with Clinton. They couldn't get Clinton to do what they wanted because Clinton was too focused on Clinton and Clinton's needs, and they wanted a whole series of attacks on him. They came close to an attack on Haiti. That would not have gotten them very far. It was really only when Clinton had been thoroughly weakened by the Watergate, by the impeachment, that he was then willing to start the bombing of Serbia, which implied a kind of a path towards confrontation with Russia, because that was the goal, right, to create conflict with Russia through the attack on Serbia. However, when Bush came in, Bush the Younger, the neocons were all around him, and they expected that this would lead to a change. And it didn't. And the neocons, we're also talking about the people above and behind the neocons, the people who actually have power in as distinct from people who appear as public officials or journalists. I mean, the people more in the Alan Dulles camp than the sort of Richard Perl camp. These people in the background were watching when the U.S. Reconnaissance plane was brought down or came down on the coast of China, and the Chinese therefore had this American plane. The goal of the neocons in this establishment, you can look at the Weekly Standard of those days, they wanted Bush to use this for an all-out confrontation with China. And the fact is, Bush did nothing. So here was a wonderful opportunity to get some kind of enemy image going, to go for a confrontation with the Chinese, humiliate the central government, make them lose face, maybe promote the breakup of China. They've never given up on that. And Bush did nothing. He completely wasted this occasion. The other people in this debate seem to think that the world revolves around the Middle East. The world does not revolve around the Middle East. Zionists think that the world revolves around Israel. I don't. There seem to be a lot of people on this call who think that somehow Israel is the focal point of the world. It is not. The big picture, Russia, China, India, U.S., Europe, the big picture is much broader than simply the Middle East. The Middle East plays, of course, an important role. The goal of 9/11 is to put the U.S. on the offensive in every international forum. They walk into ASEAN. They walk into the Organization of American States, and they say, whatever your agenda is, forget it. We're going to be talking about the global war on terrorism. We're going to be talking about what you have to do for the United States. No discussion of economic development. No discussion of world monetary reform. In my book, 9/11 Synthetic Terror Made in USA, I have a discussion of all the Arab countries that were at this time considering a withdrawal from the dollar. North Korea had withdrawn from the dollar. Iraq had withdrawn from the dollar, as people know, and transformed the oil for food fund from dollars into euros. And that was going on in quite a few other countries. So the idea was to create a situation where if you came up and said, I'm sick and tired of dollar domination, as Mahathir Mohamad of Malaysia was arguing very persuasively, the idea of dumping the dollar. Well, if 9/11 comes along, if you're talking about getting rid of the dollar, you become a terrorist and you are on the defensive. So it is the act of a desperate, crisis-ridden, dying imperialism. It indicates a degree of desperation in the Anglo-American ruling class, which I think indicates their weakness. It is, once again, as a historian, I have to say the idea that 9/11 is a radical departure from the U.S. tradition is simply bunk. It's baloney. It's a thesis which has been, you know, the facts has been fitted around the political judgment that people are pushing, which, again, I detect a great deal of animus and hatred going on here in the background. Understandable. But remember, it's better not to be blinded by hate. If you're so blinded by hatred of Bush, you may get Obama. If you're so blinded by hatred of Obama, you may get Romney and fascist economics. So it's better to stay away from the hate. It's perfectly in continuum with the U.S. tradition, and you don't need to look outside. You don't need anybody to export evil into the United States. There's plenty here. It's called the Wall Street banking community. And I would also add that group, of course, is the one group where the Nazi continuum is perhaps the greatest, right? The people like Prescott Bush that I wrote about in George Bush, the Unauthorized Biography, published 20 years ago. Prescott Bush, the Wall Street banker, the Wall Street banker who financed Hitler, was, of course, typical of a whole group in Wall Street, including the Dulles brothers and many more. So we have Nazis in Wall Street who maintain this tremendous power in the U.S. government when other groups of Nazis are being broken up in various places around the world.
Mr. Tarpley, could I possibly ask a follow-up? Because it seems to me that what the nut of your answer was that 9/11 was done to ratchet up U.S. dominance worldwide and to essentially give us permission, to start wars all over the world. Now, if you look at what has happened after 9/11, if you look at the NDAA, the Enemy Expectation Act, and the massive surveillance machine, domestic surveillance machine put into effect after 9/11, it would seem that at least one of the targets appears to be the United States. Particularly, sorry, losing my voice there, if you look at that grotesque Section 817 of the U.S. Patriot Act, which gives the U.S. government permission to violate the Biological Weapons Convention domestically, and that means, again, target U.S. citizens. I'm wondering if you could possibly speak to the perception that that possibly one of the wars is against us.
It absolutely is. But the idea is not, it's not to increase U.S. domination. It is to save the empire, to rescue the empire from impending collapse. It's not we control the world, we want to control the world more. It's, oh my God, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the BRICS, everybody is fleeing the dollar and our domination, and we've got to save the entire world picture. And then concerning the internal fascistization, well, the idea of using poison gas against your own population is in my book. It comes from Carl Schmitt in the Weimar Republic, right? The father of the neocon movement. Obviously, right now we have the same fascistization and totalitarianism that we had under Bush, but now we have it under Obama, except that we have it under left auspices, and the resistance is correspondingly practically non-existent. This is what I warned against in my books, Obama the Postmodern Coup and Barack H. Obama the Unauthorized Biography, published 4 years ago, saying this will be a new Carter, this will lead to a reactionary nightmare, but in the meantime, he will carry on the wars. And of course, Obama turns out to be a bigger warmonger than Bush ever dreamed of being.
I'm going to ask a question here from Walt Brown. James, you probably know who Walt is, eh?
Sure, yes. He's quite prominent in JFK research.
That's right.
Why is the best available video about 9/11, why was it taken by Israeli intelligence? How did they know to be there? That's a heck of a coincidence.
I don't know whether he's talking about the Naudé brothers' video of plane hitting the North Tower, the very first video. But if he is, I think he's probably right. As my understanding is that the Naudé brothers are very likely to be Israeli intelligence assets, and that the chances of them having caught that North Tower hit, assuming it was what we're told it was, which is another assumption, would be just about zero. You know, that we were told they were out filming firefighters in the streets of New York and just happened to look up at the instant that plane zipped across the sky at over 500 miles per hour, a highly unlikely, if not completely impossible, speed for a passenger aircraft of that description at that altitude, and somehow caught it going into the tower. I think we can assume that this was a setup. And so that's one case of the best video. There are other claims that the so-called dancing Israelis, who were a group of Israeli spies arrested after they had been filming and celebrating the hit on the, I guess both tower hits and then the destruction of the towers. Those guys were arrested, held for months, given they repeatedly failed lie detector tests. They were arrested with thousands of dollars in cash stuffed in their socks. They were working for a known Mossad front called Urban Moving Systems. Mm-hmm. And after they were ordered, sent back to Israel by Chertoff, they went on Israeli TV and said that they were there in New York to document the event. So those are two cases of very good video being taken by Israeli assets in New York. And I assume that's what he's talking about.
Oh, I think Kevin has covered it very nicely. Yes, they were, when the residents noticed them celebrating and congratulating one another dressed in Arab garb, they were very suspicious. And when the police apprehended them, the arresting officer walked up to the driver's side and the driver said, "We are not your problem. Your problem is our problem. The Palestinians are the problem." As Kevin observed too, they had box cutters. There were traces of explosives. They had passports and money. They were incarcerated for 71 days before then assistant to the Attorney General John Ashcroft directed their release and went back to Israel precisely as he described. You can watch their appearance on Israeli television on YouTube. And of course, this person who directed their release, Michael Chertoff, was a joint U.S.-Israeli citizen who would go on to become the head of our Department of Homeland Security, which I regard as one of the greatest catastrophes in the history of American government, to merge all of these independent departments, which were performing their functions quite brilliantly, successfully, and where there was a certain degree of competition, which is the best way to ensure that you have the opportunity to discover the truth, being merged into a single entity that was destined to become the core of a new American Gestapo, was a great tragedy. and ought to be reversed if we had any control over our government whatsoever.
Which we don't.
Let's take another question, guys. Why don't we have Webster Tarpley and Joshua Blakeney make a response to this one?
Hi, this is Sonia from the YouTube channel, The Truther Girls and thetruthergirls.com. And it's known that the 9/11 Commission only investigated up to the initiation of the collapse. And there's ample evidence that 9/11 was a controlled demolition and that there was a cover-up. Yet efforts to get a reinvestigation going are repeatedly blocked. So do you think we'll ever see a reinvestigation? And if so, under what circumstances?
Webster Tarpley?
Well, concerning the 9/11 Commission, they have condemned themselves. Governor Kane of New Jersey and the long-term congressional hack Lee Hamilton wrote a book. I guess it was for the fifth anniversary of the event. In 2006, where they admitted that U.S. Air Force officials had committed massive perjury to the commission in terms of the timelines, what they knew, when they knew it, how they reacted. Planes in the air, not in the air, and so forth. So they've essentially said this was perjury. Now, I brought this up to Kay in that debate, and he said, oh, but it was given to the Inspector General of the Air Force. His name happened to be Göring. Maybe that was a coincidence. Maybe not. But Göring came back and said, oh, no problem, no violation. So that's an in-house investigation of the Air Force. Of course, what's he going to do? Find that his own commanding officer is part of a conspiracy for a coup d'etat? No, not going to happen. In terms of getting to the truth, I think you've got to be brutally realistic. All of these attempts to use legal remedies or court remedies or petition campaigns, so much time and effort has been wasted on this. I could only respond with a parable. It's known today that the Nazis, in particular Göring, that we just mentioned, burned the Reichstag in 1933 as part of a clear effort to wipe out parliamentary rule, right? Wipe out the German parliament and create a Nazi dictatorship, which then immediately followed. The problem is that they created a false flag story around this, right? They blamed the mentally incompetent Dutch communist, they alleged, van der Lubbe. They executed him. There was Dimitrov was in the trial, a communist international functionary. He somehow got off. But that was the story that stood. And I would say if Hitler had won the Second World War or had remained in power, most academics and quackademics today would be saying that the communists burned the Reichstag. It was only the military defeat of Hitler, the opening up of the archives, and above all, the change in the climate of world public opinion that opened it up to the actual truth. So if you want to get the truth on 9/11, you're going to have to get into those archives. You're going to have to be able to subpoena all kinds of witnesses. You're going to have to subpoena, for example, the commander of the Northeast Air Defense Sector, Griffiths Air Force Base, Rome, New York, and ask him, why did you not launch your planes? And why, when you did you send them out over the North Atlantic and get in there? You'd also have to subpoena the heads of quite a few private military firms, right? The Blackwaters and DynCorps and so forth, and grill them all. Where were you on 9/11? Where were you during the weeks leading up to 9/11? So if you want to get the truth on 9/11, join the effort to break the power of finance capital and break their power. Part of that will be getting the sources of truth so that this illusion can eventually be swept away. Otherwise, you're going to have to wait at least 100 years or so until some other empire dominates the world, and maybe they'll have an interest in doing it. But then the books will be written in Chinese, won't they?
Greg, you're just stewing over there. Why don't you get it off your chest?
Okay. If we're talking about what Sonia talked about, getting the information for September the 11th, you might want to ask the Federal Bureau of Investigation why they went into the air control towers and personally demanded all records of that attack and destroyed them. So why would the United States destroy evidence from this attack if, in fact, the United States had committed it, as Webster Tarpley alleges? There's more to this than simply hiding behind the standard cliche of finance capital being the great bogeyman in all this. What we need to recognize is, contrary to Mr. Tarpley's denials, Israel had forewarning of this attack. We know this because the instant messaging service Odigo, which has offices both in Herzliya, Israel, and in, I believe, Georgia, the United States, had 2 hours warning. The head of Odigo, Misha Makover, received a text message or a voicemail message, I forget exactly, it's in my book, The Host and the Parasite, in which he was told that the attack on the World Trade Center was imminent. Now, how is it possible that Israel could have known this 2 hours before the attack? Now, Makover has admitted this in Haaretz newspaper, so I'm not making this up. And if you figure that, if you remember that Odigo is owned partially by the Israeli government, it's strange credulity to think that Israel had no role in this at all. Because if we're supposed to believe that this is simply an attack by the United States to expand its imperial reach all over the world, then you have to end up in some sort of irrational world whereby you commit such an atrocity that you could have achieved the same event through other means. Now, the argument that the attack on Iraq was about oil doesn't hold water. If America wanted oil that badly, it could have found a way to deal with Saddam Hussein. And America's dealt with nasty people its entire life. And if you look at the oil imports from Iraq during the 1980s, there's virtually none. So we have to look at a motive other than oil for the attack on Iraq. And water is a major reason why, and the fact that Saddam Hussein had a large army sitting on the Saudi border causing the Saudis fits, that sounds like a more reasonable motive. The only motive for the attack on September the 11th has to be found outside the United States. It does not make sense for the United States to go out of its way to demonize the Muslim world and expect to expand its imperial stretch without engendering massive hostility. There is no scenario conceivable under which the United States would willfully do this. The United States has treated the Muslim world with paternalistic disregard. It takes its oil, it ignores the abuses in the various countries. I mean, it ignored the abuses in Iran for decades, so long as it got the oil from the Shah. Jimmy Carter did not want to know what was going on. The United States does not give a damn about democracy in the world. Democracy is an expensive impediment to the cheap extraction of natural resources from countries who have what we have, but we want to take it. So we have to look for reasons beyond oil, beyond American self-interest, and you have to recognize, I believe, that American self-interest, American national interest, has been completely destroyed. America is simply an outpost of the Israeli Zionist Empire. Israel has infiltrated the United States to the extent that America as an independent country, as I have said, does not exist. We look at the Americans running the show. We think they're running the show. We see American congressmen and senators and presidents, but the people telling them what to do are not Americans. They're Israelis. They're Zionist Americans. They're people who have agendas beyond what is considered the traditional American point of view. We have to stop intoning the standard political science slang of imperialism and finance capital. This is sterile talk. This is talk that does not belong in the concept of September the 11th. And I think we need to cleanse our mind, take a step back, and assume a world in which everything is irrational, that what doesn't seem to make sense does make sense. If we assume America is doing it for rational purposes, then we end up in no man's land. If we assume that America is not in control of its own destiny, that it's being manipulated, then the stupid acts do seem to make sense.
Joshua, is the enemy foreign or domestic?
I believe there's a Zionist power configuration, which is it partly in Israel and partly in the U.S. and other Western countries. I think Dr. Tarpley hit the nail on the head when he said for the American empire builders, the Middle East doesn't matter that much. And that was Israel's greatest fear, that while during the Cold War, Israel served U.S. imperial interests, at least say up till 1980, because after 1967, they proved themselves to be a formidable fighting force who could crush Arab nationalism. After the Cold War, it was rational from a U.S. national interest to cozy up with Israel's enemies in the Middle East. Saddam Hussein fired Scud missiles at Israel in 1991, and he compensated the families of martyrs in Palestine. Look what happened to South Africa when it was expedient for the American Empire to use the white racist apartheid regime in the context of the Cold War. They did, and when it became inexpedient, they cast them adrift, and democracy flourished, and the indigenous people of the region ousted the ethnic nationalists. Likewise, without 9/11 aligning U.S. policy and demonizing Israel's enemies. So, you know, obviously in the case of South Africa, the American Empire used South Africa until it became inexpedient for them to use South Africa, and they cast them adrift and democracy flourished in the region. Likewise, after the Cold War, it's obvious the U.S. had no vested interest in propping up Israel anymore. You talk about people like Richard Pearl, but I would say these are Israeli empire builders, not American empire builders. Wolfowitz and Feith, you know, they were investigated and lost their security clearances for passing classified documents to Israel in the 1990s. When we cite Carl Schmitt, it's noticeable that Dr. Tarpley leaves out Strauss, who kind of fused those Nazi ideas with Zionist supremacism. And Strauss was the founding father of the neocons philosophically, as Dr. Barrett demonstrates so well in his presentations. And so I think what's happened is that the American empire has become a colonized empire. The American empire, and it's not a denial of, I'm a Marxist, to be quite honest, but I view these things as class, and within the ruling class, you have factions, and whenever there's imperialism, you usually have a new faction emerge that ousts the old one. Look at the American Revolution. You had these guys in the 13 colonies saying, we don't like taking orders from London, from this metropolis in London, and they took over the Americas, basically, because, of course, under British mercantilism, they wanted to stay near the coast. Likewise, the Israelis don't like getting told what to do by Washington, because you get these so-called realists in the U.S. imperial establishment who are often safely ensconced with their oil companies in Houston and Dallas, like George Bush's father, for example, who don't really care if they're selling weapons to Saddam Hussein, and that's only really a threat to Israel, and that's out of sight, out of mind for these American empire builders. But for Israel, it's disastrous when these oil companies buttress these strongmen, Arab strongmen in the Middle East. And so there's a great deal of scholarship on this, too, in the pro-Palestinian movement, for example. It's a vigorous debate, a vibrant debate that's going on right now in the pro-Palestinian movement. Is the Zionist tail wagging the American dog? And just to negate that scholarship and just talk about Prescott Bush, again, that's trivial, like bin Laden, because we know that George Bush was just a useful idiot for these neocons. I mean, you had this whole slew of liberal scholarship, that often by liberal Zionists, talking about Rumsfeld Cheney Bush, who are noticeably like the only non-Zionists or non-people who aren't of Jewish ethnicity in the neocons. A preponderance of the neocons are basically individuals of Jewish ethnicity who defected from the left in the because after the Vietnam War, many in the Democrat Party and many on the left in Trotskyite movements became very isolationist, very anti-interventionist. And I ask people again, you know, how many Middle Eastern countries did the U.S. invade overtly in the Cold War? And the answer is very few, maybe Lebanon. Briefly, very few. The whole raison d'etre of the neocons was interventionism. You know, you read Charles Krauthammer, you know, wrote about the unipolar moment after the Cold War. That it was the time for the U.S. to intervene and do kind of social engineering. And if we define the factions in the ruling class, we have to recognize that what James Petras has called the Zionist power configuration does exist. It's not just a lobby, it's more than a lobby, because many owners of capital, many professors, dentists, journalists, many people in positions of influence in the elite, in the cerebral classes, are people whose first allegiance is to the State of Israel. And this nouveau riche faction has kind of taken over the American empire. Just as, for example, Simon Bolivar got irritated with the Peninsulares coming from Spain and telling the Creoles in Latin America how to run the colonies. Likewise, in the Middle East, Netanyahu and those guys, Sharon, this is the Sharon doctrine that's being implemented. They don't like getting told by people like George Bush Sr., you know, how to run the Middle East and how to deal with the natives from their perspective.
We have another question, this time from Anthony F. Sanchez.
This is Anthony F. Sanchez. I'm the author of UFO Highway, and I'm happy to be participating on this panel today. And my question is about Building 7, a former skyscraper that stood on the block immediately north of the block that contained the rest of the World Trade Center complex. The top three points that strike me the most about Building 7 are, one, that Building 7 was not hit by any aircraft. Two, it did not suffer massive damage from the violent destruction of either of the twin towers. And three, that small fires were observed in a few different parts of the building prior to its collapse. The destruction of Building 7 looked exactly like a standard controlled demolition. There was no official explanation as to why it collapsed. How could ancillary damage from the Twin Towers have been the cause for Building 7's destruction when Building 6 and the Fay Street, which separated Building 7 from the North Tower, went completely undamaged, aside from debris? Doesn't this point to clear evidence that this was a premeditated and controlled disaster? And finally, what are the reports that credit card transactions in the minutes before the planes crashed into the towers might have amounted to more than $100 million in value? Considering that the subsequent destruction of the computer systems eliminated all data related to this surge in credit card activity, what does this imply about the true nature of the events on that day? Thank you very much. Again, this is Anthony F. Sanchez. I'm the author of UFO Highway. Thank you.
Well, I those are good points, and those are the Achilles heels of the entire thing. Let me just say, I have a whole chapter about Leo Strauss. I did a close reading of Leo Strauss, and just because I can't get every detail in, our friend Joshua seems to be interested in scoring debaters' points at any cost. The idea that the United States was engaged in few wars or aggressions during the Cold War, I'm really sorry.
In the Middle East, I'm talking about.
I'm sorry. We had Vietnam. We had the Dominican Republic. We had all sorts of places.
In the Middle East.
Getting into a kind of a chop logic festival here. The main issue, though, is this. Are we going to look to Zionism and the international Zionist lobby or whatever this is, or the rogue network, the invisible government, parallel government, secret government of the United States? It is the latter, most emphatically. And is the latter because look at the historical continuity. This notion that you're breaking with a tradition seems designed to get away from the fact that it goes all the way back to the McKinley assassination in the 1890s, the attack on the Maine. In other words, it is the union of the City of London and the House of Morgan in Wall Street. Their ability to control the U.S. national debt and therefore that's the enemy.
Can I just make a quick point? I really like Webster. I agree with you on Roosevelt. I agree with you. I agree with you on postmodernism. I think you're a brilliant analyst. I just think that you've misdiagnosed the war on terror, premised on your belief that this is a continuation. You know, it's the Al-CIA, it's the Mujahideen, that they were involved in 9/11 somehow, even though there's no evidence for that. It's certain. I just think it's really important that, as kind of colleagues in this movement, that we address these differences that we have. And I agree with you on Ron Paul. I agree with you on so many things, Webster. But on this issue, I think you've underemphasized the Zionist power. And I think others would agree with me.
Kevin, is Webster is Webster right or not?
Well, I think actually Webster and Joshua are both about half right. I think that the invisible government that Webster talks about has had an increasing Zionist focus with this rise of the nouveau riche Zionists. All of the data, ranging from the Fortune magazine type of data to various Jewish magazines, all tell us that about half of the richest individuals in the U.S. Are Jewish. And you can bet, even though average Jews in the U.S. are not all entirely Zionist or even pro-Zionist, you can bet that these billionaires are. And when you have half of the richest people in a nation like the USA who are very strongly, viscerally committed to an enterprise, you'd better believe that that enterprise is likely to get the support of that nation. So I think that this hidden government that Webster talks about and that has done all these false flag activities in the past, that is run by the financiers, and of course among those financiers, the Rothschild and allied European banking interests, which Rothschilds, of course, did found Israel as a capital for their future. And I think that they've basically merged. And, you know, it doesn't mean that everybody who's running the show now is Jewish or Zionist directly. It's just that that secret government has taken on a lot of Zionist influence. And I think that the reason for that is that the state of Israel faces an even bleaker future than Anglo-American capitalism. The CIA study leaked a few years ago said that Israel won't be there in 20 years. Now, people like Wolfowitz and Pearl, who lost loved ones in the Holocaust, have gone on record saying that this would be worse than another Holocaust, the loss of the state of Israel. They're so fanatically committed to this project project, that you take that kind of fanatical commitment on the part of a group that includes half of the wealthiest people in the nation today, and which, you know, has had increasing percentages of the U.S. elite over the past decades. And I think you can see how this American elite that Webster speaks of has become much more committed to Zionism. And so I think that people like Joshua and Greg and others who've argued for Zionist influence on the elite are correct, but Webster is also correct. It's just that he maybe hasn't fully appreciated the latest turn of this elite towards the fanatical protection of greater Israel at all costs, even at cost to the U.S. empire.
Building 7, if I may say, is among the most robust ever designed by the hand of man. It was erected over two enormous electrical generators providing electricity for lower Manhattan. It came down in a classic controlled demolition. There's a brilliant short video entitled "This Is an Orange" by Anthony Lawson that illustrates it. What many people do not realize is that Barry Jennings from the New York City Emergency Management Unit was in the building that morning. He'd gone to Rudy Giuliani's command and control center, which had its own air and water supply. He found half-eaten sandwiches, still steaming coffee. A fireman came along and said, "We got to get you out of there." While he was getting out, there were explosions going on. A stairwell was blown out from under him. At one point, he felt himself stepping over dead bodies. He couldn't see them, but he could feel them with his feet. When he got outside, he gave interviews to reporters, some of which have not been sanitized and can be still found on the YouTube. Indeed, the oddity is that at 4:57, Jane Stanley of the BBC was reporting that the Solomon Brothers building, another name by which it was known, had collapsed, where you could view over her left shoulder the building standing in the background. It would not actually come down in a classic controlled demolition until 5:20, where this is among the most embarrassing incidents, a collusion between the mass media, the intelligence agencies, and the government ever captured in live television in its history, and when the NIST finally got around to releasing its report on Building 7, whose demise had not even been mentioned in the 9/11 Commission report, Barry Jennings, who would have been in a position to contradict its findings, was found dead just a few days prior. Not the only case of an unusual death related to 9/11.
We'll take the last call of the show.
Hi, this is Syrian Girl. I'm a YouTube blogger and a Syrian patriot. You might have seen my videos on Syrian Girl Partisan channel on YouTube, and I have a Twitter as well, Partisan Girl. I just wanted to ask you a question about the planes that hit the Pentagon and whether there was any footage of this, and what is the official story behind the Pentagon, because it's one of the ones you don't really hear much about.
Webster Tarpley, what is the official story when it comes to the Pentagon and 9/11?
The official story is it's an airliner, right? It's one of the hijacked ones, but this was the part that collapsed immediately. Thierry Masson, back in September 2001, still put out the thesis that this was not an aircraft, not a passenger aircraft of any kind, but some kind of a cruise missile, manual unmanned aerial vehicle, and so forth. And my understanding on this is in the terms of the drills, and this is where you always want to go to explain each of these, is that the object hitting the Pentagon is a figment of Amalgam Virgo 01. A U.S.-Canada multi-agency drill with NORAD. It is a unmanned aerial vehicle launched from a rogue freighter in the Gulf of Mexico or a cruise missile from a barge in the Atlantic Ocean. You simply transpose that to something coming out of Chesapeake Bay or Lake Erie or something like this and hitting the Pentagon. You've got some kind of a non-passenger aircraft device. And, of course, there are fanatics who are now cursing because there's a whole body, there's a hysterical kind of cult that is based on the notion that, yes, indeed, it was a passenger aircraft. But I think the essence of it is what you find in the drill.
Well, the official account has Flight 77, which wasn't even scheduled to fly that day, approaching the Pentagon at about 500 miles an hour, just barely skimming the ground and encountering multiple lampposts. It turns out this is both aerodynamically and physically impossible aerodynamically, because of that speed, an aircraft of that size would accumulate a packet of compressed gas. It's referred to as ground effect, and would actually be unable to get any closer than about a wing length. In this case, the span of the wings was 125 feet, about 60 feet to the ground, and couldn't have hit any of the lampposts. Plus, of course, we know from Newton that a plane traveling 500 miles an hour hitting a stationary lamppost has the same effect as a stationary plane being hit by a lamppost moving 500 miles an hour. It would have ripped the wing off the plane. The jet fuel stored there would have burst into flames. It would have catapulted, its tail broken off, done great damage to the lawn. But in fact, it turns out the lawn is perfectly clear, green, and unblemished for a very substantial period of time. We have photograph after photograph after photograph. It turns out that when pilots for 9/11 Truth obtained black box data that the NTSB claimed had come from Flight 77 and subjected it to analysis, they discovered that it corresponded to a plane on a completely different due east approach that was 300 feet in the air, too high to hit any lampposts, that a second from impact was 100 feet above the Pentagon, which corresponds to the report of a trucker buddy of a friend of mine from JFK Research, Roy Schaefer, whose friend Dave Ball told him he'd been in front of the Pentagon and watched a commercial carrier fly toward it and then swerve over it. I was so fascinated by what Dave had to say that I told Roy I'd like to get him on the radio to interview him. Roy asked Dave about it, but he was reluctant. And I'm very sorry to say that within a few weeks, he was found dead in an abandoned building. Another witness, I'm sorry to say, who knew too much. I'd be glad to add on that, of course, we have one of the most celebrated witnesses in all of 9/11, April Gallup, who is a civilian employee who brought her infant to work with her that morning, and where when the plane approached the building to swoop over it, explosions were set off in front of the building to make it appear as though there was a cause-effect relationship, when that was manifestly not the case. But April walked out of the enormous hole in the front of the Pentagon with and looked around and saw no signs whatsoever of any plane having crashed there. In fact, the photographs of the actual hit point, which was on the ground floor, only about 10 feet high and 16 or 17 feet wide, include a chain link fence, two enormous spools, a cable, a couple of automobiles, and unbroken windows surrounding the hit point were no less an authority than Major General Albert Stubblebine, who had formerly been responsible for all United States photographic intelligence, offered an interview in Germany that it was obvious to him from having studied the photographs that no plane had hit the Pentagon, where he substantiated that by observing that it was easy for him to determine because there was no imprint of any wings there. The Pentagon walls were 2 feet thick, one foot of concrete, 8 inches of bricks, and then 4 inches of limestone, which is a very soft, porous stone. If, in fact, a plane had hit there, there would have been an indelible impact from the aircraft's presence. But, in fact, we do not have a massive pile of aluminum debris from a 100-ton airliner. We do not have the wings. We do not have the tail. We do not have body seats and luggage. Astonishingly enough, not even the engines, which are virtually indestructible, were recovered from the Pentagon.
As a matter of fact, if you want to go into further, Jamie McIntyre of CNN was broadcasting right from the Pentagon soon after the event, and he says, and I quote, "From my close-up inspection, there is no evidence of a plane having crashed anywhere near the Pentagon." So CNN has this on the air, and, you know, what more evidence do you need? And yet people will still believe today that we have, you know, that the plane hit the Pentagon.
Well, I have it, Greg, and I'm going to play it during the Vancouver hearing so everyone can hear Jamie McIntyre speak for himself, and precisely as you say, when he was asked by an anchor about this, you know, crash and the collapse of the structure, that collapse didn't happen for nearly 30 minutes after the original impact. And as Jamie observed from his own close-up inspection, there were no indications of any large plane having crashed anywhere near the Pentagon. And indeed, later, he would be subjected to political pressure and say, undoubtedly under duress, that anyone would be a fool if they thought a plane had not hit the Pentagon. Subsequently, of course, he would retire from the news service. I believe his conscience must have caused him such anguish that he couldn't endure the hypocrisy.
Yeah, this is what Dan Rather did after he left. He talked about just how corrupt the news industry was. But one thing, I'll let go in 1 second, but look how badly executed this whole attack was. I mean, could they not come up with a better cover story? I mean, Building 7 collapsed, couldn't have been hit by a plane. The Pentagon attack was a non-entity. The Shanksville plane, there was no wreckage found. And as far as the other buildings go, it took them too long to fall. And this was a very badly executed false flag operation.
But remember, Greg, it was good enough for a gullible American public who are so used to fantasy and television and the movies, they can no longer distinguish between the real and the illusory. It's like a magic act by David Copperfield where their attention is distracted while the real action takes place. And because the American people have had such faith in their own government, it becomes traumatic to even contemplate the possibility that the government, for its to promote its own political agenda, could have sacrificed the lives of 3,000 of our fellow citizens. It's comparable to the discovery that a woman makes that there are signs her husband may have been molesting their daughter. It's so traumatic, it's so threatening to her core beliefs that she suppresses the information, and years later, when the truth emerges, she cannot explain why she did nothing about it. Psychologists refer to this phenomenon as cognitive dissonance, and I think it's the principal reason why so many Americans have been unwilling to take seriously that 9/11 was indeed an inside job, no matter how massive and convincing the evidence.
Yeah, I was going to ask Dr. Barrett to just explain the Zionist takeover of the Pentagon, because I know he's interviewed a lot of eyewitnesses to the Israeli takeover of the Pentagon, the establishment of the Office of Special Plans, and so on. I think he'd be in a good position to explain that did take place to us.
Karen Kwiatkowski has talked about this quite a bit. She was working at the Pentagon at the time, and after 9/11, at a time when she said that Israelis were being given the run of the place. They could go anywhere they wanted. They were sort of a master race within the halls of the Pentagon. And she has, and others have described how under the Bush regime, the Pentagon Office of Special Plans was liaised with Vice
President.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry, Josh. Kevin's having a problem, but what Kevin is saying is perfectly correct. And the chapter in my book does talk about this, how the Pentagon, the Zionists and Jewish agents in America had free run of the Pentagon. They could go in to see Douglas Feith without signing in. And there's one scene in my book where I describe how this one secretary or woman at the front of Feith's office says, tell these people to sign in, and they don't, and Feith just waves them in. And she looks kind of just worried and a little bit concerned that this is, you know, contrary to protocol. I mean, you have these Israelis having free run of the Pentagon, and I think, and I want to pick up what Jim said. Jim is perfectly correct. Cognitive dissonance is the greatest enemy we have in refusing to see the reality before us, even if that reality goes against our moral comfort zone, our cognitive comfort zone. And the cognitive dissonance that we see today is that there is continuity between early America before 1980 and after 1980. There is no continuity. The continuity of American policy and American philosophy was ruptured with the election of Ronald Reagan. And from Ronald Reagan until the present, America slides ever faster into fascism. And this is the one thing why we have to acknowledge that America lost control of its own country. And this is how Israel, through the 1980 election in the lower levels of government, managed to infiltrate and suffuse itself throughout the apparatus. And that is how we have an America under essentially Israeli domination.
Webster Tarpley, you're going to...
If I may, I think this is simply now an absurd distortion. We're dealing with an invisible government, which represents the takeover of the federal government by Wall Street networks.
No.
We can trace this back to the 1890s. We can trace back certain precursors of this into the period of 1811 to 1816, when it was the Astor Bank and the Girard Bank of Philadelphia that attempted something similar. Now, in the middle of this, there is, of course, what used to be known as our crowd, right? since we're so focused on ethnicity, right? We want to know everybody's religion and pedigree. We could also say, sure, Kuhn Loeb, Salomon Brothers, Lehman Brothers, the Schiffs, the Warburgs, and all these people. They've been part of this really since the 1890s. We had Seligman. Seligman was a big influence in the Grant administration. But the notion that this somehow takes over the United States, you are dealing with a transatlantic faction of financiers. One leg is in the city of London, one leg is in Wall Street. Now, within this, you might say that the group that's most heavily identified with Israel is the most utopian. They're the most adventurous. They're the ones that are most reliant on war. They reflect to some degree, as people have said, the desperation of the Israeli strategic predicament, the insuperable contradictions that they're getting over. But let's look at it from the point of view of somebody who wants to do something about it, right? Not just propagandize, protest, and complain, but what do you want to do about it? My interest is to create a mass movement going beyond Occupy, beyond the important beginnings that have been made in Wisconsin and Ohio and Michigan and Indiana and other places, to build a self-conscious mass movement to break the power of Wall Street over the U.S. federal government. If you pose your political project in these terms, which are the scientifically and historically accurate terms, you will enjoy broad support. But if you start with this notion, which I think is ahistorical and wrong, it is a misdirection, a misalignment of saying, I'm leading a campaign to break Zionist control over the United States, you're going nowhere. And I think that is the issue. It's wrong. It leads nowhere. It's a loser. It is a distortion. And I would urge people to consider that.
I'm sorry. You know, I think we're talking about two different histories here, Webster. You're talking about financial history and the banking. That's fine, and I don't disagree with that. But you're making a fundamental error conflating that with September the 11th. And that's where I think you've made your mistake, because you cannot make any rational scenario in which the United States would allow itself to be so badly mistreated by Israel.
It is a rogue network that is not interested in these questions of national honor or whatever you're saying. In other words, it's not the U.S. government as a whole. The Post Office Department is not much involved. The Department of Agriculture, rather peripheral in this entire thing. It is a network, a private network, across the top of these institutions. This is the network that sent Bush the message, Angel is next, do what we say, or you're expendable, right? Bush, Cheney, all expendable. Maybe we should look at the fact that Brent Scowcroft was flying around in a doomsday aircraft in the middle of the United States, perhaps as the colonel or the nucleus of a possible committee of public safety with Scowcroft and Warren Buffett in case the government in Washington had been essentially crippled. This is the kind of situation you're dealing with. And again, 46 drills, I'm sorry, they're not run from Israel. They're run from inside the Pentagon.
Yeah, but that doesn't really matter. That doesn't argue against Zionist domination. The drills could be all part of the same operation. We do not have to invent the city of London and go into all sorts of Illuminati, airy-fairy arguments.
I never said Illuminati, and I never
will. He never said that, Greg.
Fair enough. I retract that. But the city of London is often invented by people who want to talk about some sort of hidden hand behind
invented
everything.
Hey, there was something called the British Empire, quite large, right? A lot of red on the globe. Yeah,
and a new faction took it over, right? Just as the American Empire has been taken over by a new faction, the keys to the empire, the keys to the car of the British Empire were handed over to the American Empire. And now the American Empire is in decline and the Israeli empire is rising. And you've just indicated, Webster, that you want to appeal to a kind of left-wing constituency to create a mass movement in the United States. And I commend that aspiration. And obviously you must realize that many left-wing people are brainwashed to see anti-Zionism as anti-Semitism. And that might force you to have to underemphasize Zionist power. My goal is to end the genocide in the Middle East. My goal is to help the Palestinians. And I believe if we can tell the American people that they were also victims of Zionist terrorism on 9/11, they might begin to empathize with the Palestinians who are victims of Israeli terrorism on a daily basis.
Very good, Joshua. Very good.
If you want to condemn Netanyahu and his gang and Olmert and Sharon, if he's still vegetating away, you can condemn them easily based on things that they have absolutely done. The rampage in the West Bank in 2002, the attacks on Lebanon over all these years, the invasion of Lebanon in 2006, the attack on Gaza in 2008, 2009. These are real war crimes. The Israelis did these. You
but
can
it won't
condemn
resonate
it.
With the American people. It won't resonate. 9/11 will resonate with the American people and will force them to pressure their government.
Guys, I'm going to have to tell you that the expert on American history here and indeed on the American people may turn out to be me rather than people looking in from afar. And I value the comments of Palestinians about how the United States is ruled. But I also find that many of the things that come out of the Middle East are tinged by the obvious partisanship vis-a-vis the Israelis, which is very understandable, but which leads then to results which are maybe not the most exact.
You're not an expert, Webster. Sorry.
I'm not an expert. I'm just a novice.
Well, actually, Webster, I think you're a genius on so many subjects, and it kind of saddens me to see you misdiagnose the war on terror in the way that you have. And I want to tell you that I've just spent the last like 4 years going through the scholarship of Walton Mearsheimer, James Petras. He's written many books on this subject.
The people that you cite are all left liberals. These are left liberals.
Walton Mearsheimer, a realist at the University of Chicago.
A complete left liberal. This is the left liberal. This is basically the Brzezinski group, or more or less.
Yes,
and
yes.
Their idea is they are not going to attack Wall Street as the heart of the problem. They are indeed going to tell you that it's all some nefarious group of foreigners. The idea of blaming the problems of a country on foreigners and ethnic minorities is not a good bet. And you can look back to all sorts of historical examples. I won't bother you with the ones. You can figure them out quite easily, I think. You've got to identify the source of the problem in reality, not looking through the goggles of hatred or resentment or something else.
But do you not recognize there's factions in the American Empire, Webster? There are factions who are often in a position of being in contradiction to one another. Do you not recognize that?
You're too dismissive, Webster. You can't just attack people ad hominem and the left liberals. Look at their arguments. Don't dismiss them so cavalierly.
I'm a socialist. I was with Raul Castro in Cuba not long ago. I'm a socialist.
Joshua, I want to disagree with what you said. The American public will not resonate with the idea that it's a Zionist conspiracy. No way.
I think that's more realistic than what we've been hearing.
Well, Russell, anyway, I think what he's saying if the American people were presented with an enormous range and variety of evidence of Israeli complicity in 9/11, which most certainly does exist, that could have a powerful influence upon the American people.
Why don't we look at
the
complicity of the Pentagon, the CIA, the
Webster, please, kindly, you've asked that you not be interrupted. I do believe, however, that first and foremost, they need to be convinced that 9/11 was an inside job and then turn to the political aspects of it. And I just want to thank you so much for having this collective conference, because, frankly, I think the whole discussion has been quite fascinating. And I have no doubt that anyone who listens to our conversation, our exchange of views and so forth, will have their interest peaked and have, I hope, a great deal of concern and desire to join us at the Vancouver hearings, which, of course, will be held 15 to 17 June at the Denman Theater in Vancouver. And I just can't thank you enough for arranging this.
Webster Tarpley, what are you going to be discussing at the Vancouver hearings?
At the center of the issue, of course, the invisible government, the interface of Wall Street with the intelligence community, the role of these high-level operatives inside the government. This is where it was done. Not Bush, not Cheney, really. These people are brought in after the fact if they're lucky, and they were expendable on the day of. The 46 drills, as written up in 9/11 Synthetic Terror Made in USA. You can get it through my website, tarpley.net, through Progressive Press of California, through Amazon. I'm also very interested in this question of the coup, the putsch inside the U.S. government, the redirection of the entire society using this outside event. That's the Angel Is Next story. And from there, the continuum of false flag events, right, which is not just Major Hassan or Najibullah Zazi or Mutalab, the Christmas Day panty bomber, but also things like WikiLeaks, the Julian Assange, the CIA limited hangout operations, which have then been the prelude to the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring, of course, a fraud in that sense, a CIA destabilization. But the prevalence of false flag events in the contemporary world is getting bigger and bigger. It doesn't start with 9/11. It doesn't stop with 9/11. But it's been growing ever since. And things like the Obama campaign of 2008 have many of the aspects of a color revolution, and of course the Ron Paul campaign, aspects of a color revolution style event there too. So it's the idea is to be opposed to all covert operations, not just the right-wing ones, the fascist, militarist, racist ones like 9/11, but also the ones that come under left cover, like Julian Assange and people like this.
Oh, give him a break.
Sorry. CIA limited hangout operation.
His lawyer's Alan Dershowitz.
Oh, that's not good.
Okay, Kevin, yes. What are you presenting at the Vancouver hearing, sir?
Well, I'll be looking at how the history of neoconservatism intersects with 9/11, and in fact, I think makes inevitable. If 9/11 hadn't existed, the neoconservatives would have had to invent it, and I suggest that that's exactly what they did. They
yes.
said that there isn't going to be any massive Arab-Muslim attack on America, so we're going to have to invent one, and they went ahead and did. And if you read closely their philosophy, which does begin with Schmidt in Nazi Germany, it's taken over as a not entirely Jewish thing, but less Judeo-centric philosophy in any case by Leo Strauss, who moves it to America and sends it as a kind of infection to all of the major universities, urging students to devote their lives to seeking power through mendacity, violence, and basically whatever it takes. There are a bunch of Nietzschean supermen, and it's considered, you know, this kind of power seeking through lies is held up as the highest form of public service by these neoconservatives. So I think once people actually...
Greg Felton, same question.
I will be hosting the odd-numbered sessions at the conference, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Regrettably, I won't be giving a paper, which I would like to do perhaps at the next conference if Jim Fetzer would invite me. However, I will say that my book, The Host and the Parasite, How Israel's Fifth Column Consumed America, will be for sale. It is available. I'll have autographed copies, and you can buy it on Amazon as well. My second book, Exploding Middle East Myths, 15 Years of Fighting Zionist Propaganda, will also be for sale. And I'd just like to say thanks for having me on. I appreciated Joshua Blakeney. I thought he had some very good points about the conflation between the neocons. It might be interesting to note that it was the Jewish neocons, as he quite rightly pointed out, in the 1960s, particularly people like Norman Pudhoretz and so forth, who became the first of the neocons who found common cause with the Christian Zionists, mostly in moral economic matters, and started the reactionary movement in the early 70s, which culminated in the election of Reagan. And that created the discontinuity between modern America and the old America, back when old America had at least a pretense toward democracy, and the slide into fascism started in earnest. Anyway, thanks very much. I do have to leave, Russell. I will see you at the conference, I trust.
And thank you very much for being on the program, Greg.
You're welcome.
Joshua, what are you going to be discussing at the event?
Well, I'd happily sit down and discuss the crimes of the traditional American empire builders at length. Well, many crimes, the Brzezinskis and the George Bush seniors and so on, committed, but the conference is ostensibly about 9/11, and so my presentation will be entitled The Likudnik Origins of the War on Terror.
James Fetzer?
Well, thank you, Russell, for hosting this event, and I would say that I have concluded that the most effective way to convince the American people that 9/11 was a Hollywood-style fabricated event is to examine each of the four crash sites, which were faked in different ways. Flights 11 and 77 weren't even scheduled to fly that day. The planes corresponding to flights 93 and 175 were not deregistered, not formally taken out of service by the FAA until 28 September 2005, which raises the questions of how can planes that were not in the air have crashed on 9/11, and how can planes that crashed on 9/11 have still been in the air 4 years later. In addition, I will report how pilots for 9/11 Truth, on the basis of studies of air-ground communication, have been able to establish that Flight 93 was in the air, but was over Champaign, Urbana, Illinois, at the same time it was supposed to be crashing in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and that Flight 175 was also in the air, but was over Harrisburg in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. At the same time, it was supposed to be effortlessly entering the South Tower. There's much more to tell here. It's a fascinating story, and I think anyone who hears what I have to say is going to be convinced that 9/11 was a complete fraud, a complete hoax, that the American people and indeed the world were bamboozled by special effects, including many that had a Hollywood-style aspect.
How much are tickets to the event, Jim? Where do I buy them?
$25 per day or $50 for the entire event. That they're available at the Denman Theater, at Banyan Books, at the Co-op Bookstore. So if you're eager to come, you can save money by getting a conference pass for all 3 days, a single day pass, each day $25. And again, I would reiterate that we're going to talk about the Pentagon, the witnesses, and the passengers. How were the Twin Towers destroyed? The fabrication of the atrocities of 9/11? Who was responsible for 9/11 and why? And the media, the 9/11 myth, and the message.
Joshua, when I talked about the resonance, what I'm saying is if the impetus is to convince the American population that 9/11 was an inside job, you cannot achieve that through the Zionist conspiratorial angle. You're simply fighting an uphill battle. That's what I mean by what I had to say before.
Well, I got into this caring about the Palestinians, and I think 9/11 is the key to solving the Israel-Palestine impasse.
Let me ask you this, Russell, interestingly. I've been baffled why the anti-war movement hasn't linked arms with the 9/11 truth movement, because, of course, the entire war on terror has been justified on the basis of 9/11. It seems to me, once everyone understands that 9/11 was a fabricated event, that the justification for the entire war on terror collapses, and therefore there ought to be a great deal of solidarity between the two groups. And yet, I take it the anti-war movement has tended to be rather standoffish. Well, let me just add, Russell, and thank you again for arranging this wonderful exchange of views, which I personally found quite fascinating throughout, that for those who would like to learn more about the event, they should visit www.911vancouverhearings.com, where they can run through the entire program and a number of articles that explain some of the most important issues that are going to be addressed.
If I could interject, I mean, this was my greatest problem in the second half of the previous decade. The problem with the U.S. peace movement, it is controlled by foundations. It is funded by foundations. These foundations are themselves an emanation of this ruling class that we've been talking about. You've got the Ford, the Carnegie, the various foundations grouped around Soros in particular, extremely influential. They were willing to finance an anti-war movement as long as Bush was in office. But as soon as Obama came in, since Obama himself is a creature of the foundations, his mother was from the Ford Foundation, he is from the Woods, Gamaliel, Annenberg, and other foundations, foundation operatives have said, no, we will not do anything about the wars, we'll support them as long as Obama's waging the war. The critical moment was in the summer of 2006, there was a movement to get Cindy Sheehan, at that time a prominent anti-war activist, to attend the Alex Jones 9/11 event in Los Angeles, California. She was convinced not to come by Ray McGovern and some other people who said, no, don't go, keep your message pure. That, of course, guaranteed impotence, because if you're not willing to attack the premise, a number of people have pointed this out, if you're not willing to attack the premise, which is the 9/11 fraud, you cannot object to the conclusions. You cannot effectively, anyway, object to the conclusions that were drawn from them. If I believed in the 9/11 myth, some kind of military action might appear to be in order. But this, of course, this is exactly what is not true, right? There is no attack coming out of the Middle East. Al-Qaeda exists as an organization. Sure, it's a bunch of CIA patsies and terrorists. They can blow up a bus. They can blow up a supermarket. They can take part in the attack on Tripoli in Libya, but they can't do the spectacular deeds of 9/11. That's the difference.
The anti-war people tend to be left-wing, so they tend to be pro-big government. Perhaps they can't believe that the big government would do something against them.
I would urge you to look at David Swanson, right? The kind of figure that does these things. David Swanson is the point where the foundations meet the peace movement. And David Swanson, I remember him in various anti-war events here. If somebody tried to start a discussion of 9/11 in the forum of an anti-war meeting, David Swanson would freak out, try to shut them down, say this is out of order. Another guy who did this was Danny Schechter. He didn't want any discussion of 9/11. And that, of course, guarantees defeat. It's saying I prefer respectability in the short run to some hope of effectiveness in the medium to long run.
Very nice. But you've done such great work on Syria, Webster. You know, it's like left-wing people can't wrap their head around that the fact that the reactionaries who are destabilizing Syria are counter-revolutionaries, and that President Assad right now represents the kind of resistance to imperialism.
Hey, Assad is an Arab socialist, and
I know exactly.
I can tell you the prices of all the basic commodities in Syria, right?
I heard you, Webster, on guns and butter when you just got back from Syria. It was an amazing testimony of what the realities are in Syria.
Sure. Anyway, for the leftists, let me say, the essence of leftism is the New Deal. And the foreign policy of the New Deal of Roosevelt is the good neighbor policy for people of goodwill, no intervention in the internal affairs of sovereign states in Latin America or anywhere else, but also anti-fascism and anti-Nazism. Roosevelt was, of course, the greatest anti-fascist in the world. The British were appeasing Hitler. The Soviets made the Hitler-Stalin Pact. The one firm point of anti-fascism in the entire world was Roosevelt. So that's a heritage worth fighting for. And, of course, Roosevelt's enemies were precisely these pro-Nazi types or pro-British types at that time, the Stimsons, the Lovitz, the Bundys and so forth in the Pentagon, who are then the people that bring you Vietnam. So that is the tradition, and it is the tradition to some degree of the pro-Nazi, pro-fascist fifth column in the United States, which has never been disturbed by any kind of denazification.
But some would say the Zionists are kind of fascists, because fascism is really the fusion of corporations and rich capitalists with ethnic supremacism. And I kind of feel like it's much more.
This is a very reductionist view. I hear the libertarians saying, you know, the fascist corporate state, the system of state-sponsored compulsory cartels. But look, the function of fascism is, first of all, to destroy trade unions. All trade unions, independent trade unions, are destroyed by Mussolini and by Hitler. And then to carry out savage, ferocious, genocidal austerity on these countries. The Italian standard of living goes down by 30 to 40%. The German by something similar, 30%, 40%, I think is a fair guess. And lo and behold, who represents that here in the U.S. right now? Ron Paul.
I think you might be right about that, Webster, I'm sorry to say.
There's something not right there. I feel like it's too perfect. Like you know what I mean?
That's for another program. I'll
That's a whole other program,
I'll give
sir.
You the whole gespiel.
Yeah, you know what I mean, though? It's like you may as well gather up all the dissidents and have them listen to Ron Paul.
You lead them into the wilderness and you dump them there.
Absolutely. It's a controlled opposition.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And Russell, we may have differences over Ron Paul as we do over other aspects of this, because in my opinion, and having paid a great deal of attention to the Republican campaign, Ron Paul has been the only one among all of the candidates on either side of the aisle who has had a sane foreign policy, ending these wars of aggression, saying, bringing our troops home, closing these bases around the world, ending foreign aid, the Fed, all of which I think are giant steps forward.
His policy is to support the candidacy of Romney. The whole raison d'etre of his campaign is to facilitate the victory of Romney. Without Ron Paul, Romney would not have won the Michigan primary. He would not have gotten the nomination as fast as he did. Romney is the biggest warmonger. Romney says Russia is the main enemy. Romney says he wants the attack on Iran as an option, not on the table, but in his hand to strike immediately. Ron Paul is a market of dupes, a marché des dupes for our Canadian friends. It is a complete, and I was just at the Bilderberger. The main fact out of the Bilderberger is inside the Bilderberger, we have Peter Thiel, T-H-I-E-L. He is the coming generation, right? Kissinger, Brzezinski, these people are getting old, right? D'Avignon, they're on their way out. David Rockefeller, too sick even to come. Peter Thiel represents the predators, the internet derivative speculators. Well, Peter Thiel of PayPal and Facebook, part of that swindle, has given $2.7 million to Ron Paul, his super PAC. Ron Paul is therefore, the Ron Paul campaign is a paid agent of the Bilderberger Group. And I had to tell people, Russell. Jim, I think you were one of them. 4 years ago, I was telling to people, don't listen to Obama. Obama's a fraud. Right now, I say the same thing. Obama was the fraud of 4 years ago. Ron Paul is the fraud right now.
And well, Webster, today I might agree with you.
One more point. If you look at Ron Paul's economic program, you will see that all of that stuff about cutting the Pentagon budget is just not true. He does not propose that. He proposes a 15% cut in the Pentagon budget, which is what Obama's already doing. Obama budget plus sequestration minus 15% on the Pentagon. But Ron Paul wants to cut almost two-thirds of the food stamp budget. We have 50 million Americans living on food stamps. It's about $1.50 a meal. Ron Paul wants to cut that by two-thirds. We'd be at 58 cents a meal. Ron Paul spells pellagra, scurvy, rickets, and death for the American people. Genocide. It's no joke.
Webster, I think you got it right. This is the substance for another program. I may agree with you today. I may agree with you today about Obama. I take considerable exception to you today about Ron Paul, but I want to thank Russell Scott for arranging this. I think it has been an utterly fascinating exchange, and I'm tremendously in your debt, Russell.
As far as Ron Paul goes, listen, that guy was never even running for president. You know, Herman Cain, these were legitimate contenders, but Ron Paul's retiring. He wouldn't have known what to do if he had been voted in as president, and he was merely put up there. You can even see with his candor in the debates and whatnot, he's not legitimately running for president. He's there as some sort of a sideshow, and it's there to character foil Romney or whomever
In my opinion, Russell, if Webster will allow me to squeeze a few words in, he is the only candidate among them all who has any principle, who has any character, who has a vision in relation to foreign policy. Ooh. The American empire has run amok. We have overexpanded ourselves. It's like the collapse of the Holy Roman Empire. We don't have the money to afford these foreign entanglements, and we have impoverished ourselves. We've weakened our national defense. We have spent the national treasury. We have expended our military strength, and we have, alas, squandered our moral stature before the world. Before these wars of aggression, we were the most admired and respected nation in the world. Now, together with our close ally in the Middle East, we are the most despised and reviled. It's a tragic reversal of the American position in the world.
Kevin Barrett, you've been a gentleman. We've got to get going, guys. Let's wrap it up. Kevin, where can I listen to your program?
My program is on the web. To get there, go to truthjihadradio.blogspot.com. And I have shows a lot like today's conversation, 4 days a week.
And to the audience, Kevin's audio was poor because of the Skype contact. He's a brilliant man, and I would have liked to have heard more from him, but we had technical issues.
Can I acknowledge Kevin Barrett's contribution to the Vancouver hearings, too? Like, without Professor Fetzer and Professor Barrett doing the hard work for the Vancouver hearings, it wouldn't be happening. So I hope people recognize that in the coming days.
That's an absolute fact. Webster Tarpley, Professor Fetzer, Dr. Barrett, Dr. Tarpley as well, Blakeney, Greg Felton, thank you everyone for being on the program today. And to the audience, buy a ticket. Where can you get them again, James?
Oh, you can get them at the Denman Theater. You can get it at the Banyan Bookstore, and you can get them at the Co-op Bookstore. $25 for a day pass, the conference all 3 days, $50. Denman Theater, Banyan Books, Co-op Bookstore.
Thank you, gentlemen, and thank you all for being on the West Coast Truth.
Thank you. We hope to see you at the conference.
Super. Excellent. Excellent, Barbara. Well done.